वेलकम टू सीरीज नेशन स्टेट डायलॉग राष्ट्र राज्य संवाद श्रृंखला में आप सबका स्वागत है। पानिंग ताजा शो खान वो मन मिंसू को जातो फाशी लिए। माय नेम इज स्नेहल उलमन एंड आई एम द मॉडरेटर फॉर टुडेज डिस्कशन। टुडे वी हैव विद अस मिस्टर उमेश कुमार गुप्ता, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर ऑफ चाइनीज एंड अ पीएचडी स्कॉलर एट एमिटी यूनिवर्सिटी राजस्थान। ही इज अ वेटरन ऑफ इंडियन आर्मी who has excellently performed his duties of a Chinese instructor, translator and interpreter for more than a decade and was honored to be the first person in uniform to do MA in Chinese and clear the UGC NET in 2010. He has authored several books, book chapters, precy, and presented many papers on translation in national and international conferences. Mr. Gupta is a renowned Chinese translator as well. He has translated many military articles and civil documents. So today we are very happy to have him with us. Today his topic of discussion is a special lecture titled Chinese Military Translation, Theory, Discourses and Practices. So I request Mr. Gupta to carry out his presentation.
Good morning, everyone. Yeah. Thanks, Mr. Snehal, for a kind introduction. So, firstly, let me share my PPT. Okay, as Mr. Snehal introduced, that the topic of my lecture is Chinese Military Translation, Theories, Discourses, and Practices. First of all, introduction. Translation is an effective tool for cross-cultural communication. Translation that is done for the linguistic support of armed forces is termed as military translation. Modern warfare increasingly involves the huge differences in languages and cultures across national borders. Knowing how to use the multilingual notional systems to serve the war is essential to the war process. Translation has always been an inseparable war machine. In the current globalized context, the focus on language and cultural symbol systems has moved to the center position in many military operations. Military translation is a special translation meant for providing linguistic support to the armed forces. A military translator, besides having bilingual and bicultural competencies, also needs to have in-depth knowledge of the military matters. In this lecture, I would like to cover the definition, role, importance of military translation, and China's strategy on military translation, both in past and present, and will also discuss certain theoretical discourses and practices done in China. Okay, first of all, military translation. Military translation is a type of special translation carried out for the linguistic support of armed forces. Some of the researchers regard it as technical translation. Due to the technological advances in the military field, military translation becomes significant. Al Shehab from the Arab countries opines that military translators through their translation help in providing training of sophisticated weapons. Al-Kabi advocates that the origin of military translation dates back to the starting of 20th century as a new innovation in the military field. Al-Shehab identifies that only the people with the military background knowledge can do the translation effectively. In line with the other translators, military translators should also possess the linguistic competence in both the source and target languages. In addition to the bilingual and bicultural knowledge, they should also have in-depth knowledge in the military field. Also must possess the competence to bridge the communication gap between the source language and target language. Now let's discuss some definitions. According to L.L. Nelvin, military translation is a type of special translation with a clearly manifested military communication function. A distinctive feature of military translation is the heavy terminological saturation and extremely precise, clear presentation of the materials with the relative absence of figurative and emotional expressive means. R.K. Miner Belarus defines the military translation as a type of special translation for operational purpose, the object of which are military materials. Balavin Victor defines the military translation as a special type of mediated intercultural communication carried out for the linguistic support of armed forces. Now let's talk about the importance of military translation. Jalabrik emphasizes the importance of military translation in the Arab worlds. Since World War II and the advent of the modern weapons, the importance of military translation has grown manifold. Military translation may determine the whether a soldier returns to home alive or alive from the front line or is killed in the battle. The importance of military translation has grown exponentially as a result of the developing countries' heavy reliance on importing weapons from the developed countries. These Arab countries give due emphasis on the importing weapon from developed countries and their translation of the literature related to the weapon. They give due emphasis on this aspect only, while the other countries have given the importance to the other aspects. Like, let's talk about the US Department of Defense emphasizes the knowledge of foreign language, cultural and regional expertise as the critical weapon system. This is very important. Foreign language expertise, foreign language capabilities are just like critical weapon system and an organic part of combat effectiveness. On the other hand, Chinese scholar Wu Shufan considers the military translation significant for learning foreign military theories and military technology, acquiring military intelligence, and managing foreign military relations. So he has given the four aspects of the military translation. Now, as per the Wu Shufan, military translation is the integral part of the military operations. Its status and function must be closely linked to the military's existence, as well as the intent and content of the translation. Chinese scholar Wei Yuan advocates the goal of military translation to controlling foreigners, that is, strengthening the army to resist aggression, saving the world, and protecting China. The battlefield translation of Marshal Liu Pocheng seeks to develop the commanding ability of the officers at all levels in order to conquer the three mountains and liberate all of China. Today, China's military translation aims to create a strong national defense, protect national security, and enable citizens to walk in peace. Military translation obviously serves the military and politics directly, and it plays an essential and significant role in the fight for the country's, nations, and class interests. Military translation's status and importance are expressed not only in its intent, but also in the material it translates. Now let's discuss the role of military translation. Wu Shufan, a Chinese scholar, while discussing the role of military translation, says that it has considerable breadth and depth. Its field of action not only involves the various military activities in the military, but also has a varying degree of influence or effect on politics, economy, and science and technology. In terms of its depth, in political front, it is related to the country's major tasks, life and death missions. In military aspect, it involves the decision-making and command, weapons and equipments, military scientific research, etc., key elements of army building and determining the outcomes of war. In the aspect of science and technology, it first contacts with the cutting edge technology or high technology that has a significant impact on promoting the development of science and technology. In China, whether it is the past of retreat or self-presentation of today's reform and opening up, military translation has always been an important force. The translation work of Chinese PLA has gone through a glorious course of more than 60 years. The military translation team is growing day by day. Today, regardless of international and domestic political, military, technological, or economic situation, military translators are required to inherit the tradition, work harder to do their job, and make more contribution to the fourth socialist modernization. This is given by Wu Shufang. Content and scope of military translation, as per the Chinese scholar Wu Shufang, the content of military translation mainly include the following four items. First of all, military theory translation. This is actually very important aspect. He has just done translation to be done in which field, what need to be translated. So it's elaborately given four aspects. First is military theory translation. Military theory can be divided into two types. First is military thinking, and second is military academics, and is significant part of the military science. Military theory is the forerunner of all military activities. The military theories of all countries in the world are by no means the same. Therefore, the introduction, research, and learning of foreign military theories are necessary for establishing or formulating countries' warfare guidance ideas, military building guidelines, defense policies, and military regulations. Although the role of military theory is not the role of military translation itself, but without translation of military theory, foreign military theory cannot be introduced and cannot be used in China. Here, the military translation occupies an indispensable position in promoting military scientific research and providing decision-making basis for the national authorities. The next is military technical translation. It involves the translation of literature on the research, production, use, maintenance, and military engineering of various weapons and equipment. Weapons and equipment is one of the important factors of the military combat power and is material basis for the technical means for building armed forces and conducting war. Since the Second World War, the rapid development of the military technology has given the new features to modern warfare and has highlighted the positions and role of military technology in the modernization of national defense. Under this situation, any country that wants to remain invincible in this complicated international struggle will regard the introduction and absorption of the advanced foreign military technology as an urgent matter. Here, the introduction and promotion of military translation are particularly important because it is the translation by means of which China has acquired the foreign technology and used very well in the development of its weapon and equipment. Military intelligence translation. It deals with the translation of foreign military, political, economic, scientific, and technological intelligence materials obtained by various public and secret means. There are two sources, either available in public or by secret means. Know your enemy and know yourself, and you will never lose a battle. This is the primary principle of military command. The military intelligence is an important basis for formulating the strategic guiding principles and defense policies and decision making by the commanders at all levels and directing the operations. In military intelligence work, the means of obtaining intelligence is prerequisite. However, to turn the acquired information material into intelligence, it must undergo a process of translation first, then analysis and refinement. Here, the translation is an intermediate link in the transformation of information into intelligence. The role of military translation is knowing the enemy is self-evident. Military foreign related translation. It covers the interpretation and translation related to the military's contacts with the foreign enemy or friendly forces. The two aspects, either enemy or to the friendly forces aspect. The activities of the interacting with the enemy army includes propagating on the battlefield, compiling and distributing the propaganda material, providing and educating the prisoners, etc. Works related to the disrupting enemy forces. This is a political offensive carried out in conjunction with the military strikes. It is one of the three major principles of political work in Chinese army and is called psychological warfare in the West. Second is the interrogation of the prisoners of war. This is the method of gathering intelligence. Military negotiation, if the war is won or lost or is in a stalemate, it will turn to negotiation. The two sides of the war, what they can't get on the battlefield, are try to get it at the negotiation table. Conversely, if the negotiation fails, they return to the battlefield to fight. Fighting and peace talks are often cross-cutting. So exchange activities with the friendly forces include the joint of warfare, military liaison, military visits, military exchange, military advisors and training, arms trade and border exchanges, etc. This kind of exchange is aimed at uniting friends and isolating enemy in order to win the war or avoid war and maintain peace and tranquility. Military translator interpreter is the only bridge to communicate the language and writings of the Chinese military and foreign military in foreign related activities. Moreover, on many occasions, military interpreters often act as representatives of one party to deal directly with the foreign troops. In addition to the political and military function mentioned above, military translation also has a certain indirect impact on science, technology, and economy. In ancient and modern times, both at home and abroad, new achievements in the science and technology are often first applied to the military. Military technical translations are often the first to come into contact with the cutting-edge technical literature. In practice of converting the part of our military technology to civilian use, the role of military technical translation is potentially one of them. Modern warfare is an integrated context of military, politics, economic, science and technology. The demand for military intelligence must also be multifaceted. Among them, intelligence related to the economic and technological aspects can be applied to the civilian use. In addition to the military use, military translators can also do something in this regard. In addition, the military translation team is very powerful translation force. Apart from completing their work, they may make more contribution to the construction of socialism. Now let's talk about the Chinese military texts. Military texts have existed in China since the dawn of the civilization. The Chinese military has benefited greatly from Sun Tzu's rich strategic heritage. The art of war has had a profound impact on the strategic thinking in China and around the world. Military texts are said to have first appeared around 500 BC, with Sun's Ping Fa being the earliest text. The art of war, the method of Sima, six secret strategic teachings, Wei, Tiaozi, and Wuzi, are the most well-known Chinese military texts. Huang Shikong's three strategies, Hong Taizong and Li Weikong's questions and answers are the few significant texts. Now, military information documents. In China, translation of English military documents, because China is concerned with the external intelligence, which is available in English. China's, they are targeted towards the Western countries. So English military documents are very important for them. They used to translate them into Chinese so that these can be, this intelligence input can be used for various purposes. Has gradually received much attention as per Sun Changhu and Wang Shui. Strengthening the translation of English military document is to serve the national defense and army building. English military documents can be divided into at least several types, such as military theory document, military technical document, military intelligence documents, and military foreign documents. Stylistic characteristic of military information document. English military documents have distinct characteristics covering not only the military economics, foreign relations, science and technology, but also politics. Now, translation strategy of English military military information. Translation of military terms is fixed. Vast majority of military terms are univocal. Many military terms are specific. The particularity and the seriousness of military information requires that the translation must be accurate. So accuracy is the prime important thing. the sentence structure of the target text should be as concise as possible. The purpose of translating military information is to accurately convey the content of the original text to the readers. Use concise Chinese words and idiomatic sentence pattern to express the complex sentence of the original text concisely. When translating military text into English, you should pay attention to the structure and the lexical characteristic of the original text. Chinese analysis of USA's new foreign language strategy. Now, Chinese scholars, they are keep watch on the USA's various strategic action. So USA has released its document on foreign language strategy. So Chinese scholar Wang Qiufang carried out analysis of this USA's new foreign language strategy. He opens that USA issued two documents, that is roadmap and a strategic plan for strengthening the foreign language capability in its defense forces. Wang Qiufang and Su Qing, 2011, once analyzed the roadmap and pointed out that there are 4 points that Chinese military can learn from the US military. So foreign language ability is as important as good equipment or critical weapon system, as stated earlier, and is one of the core capabilities of the army. Detailed planning and a detailed and actionable solution for improving the foreign language ability of the army. This is the thing to learn. Then perfect management for forming a top-down management organization for the implementation of the roadmap. And fourth is the supervision or to be effective and the effectiveness of implementation of the roadmap to be properly supervised. So these are the 4 things which China can learn from the USA. Enlightenment on the foreign language strategy of Chinese military. The new foreign language strategy of the US Department of Defense analyze the integration of the regional knowledge and cultural capabilities. Not only the foreign language knowledge, but regional knowledge and cultural capabilities, 3 aspects are integrated together. Establish rules and regulations, transparent and standardized procedures, emphasize the multi-party cooperation and share language resources. Allied forces are to tape and utilize the human resources in various languages outside the Ministry of Defense. So author claims that compared with the US military, the mission of Chinese military is fundamentally different. It has become the norm for Chinese military to perform diversified military tasks. Chinese military talking about diversified military tasks. All these activities require Chinese military officers and soldiers to have the high foreign language skills. However, the research results show that Chinese military's foreign language skills are still seriously inadequate. For example, the joint military exercises that require translation are not yet able to communicate smoothly. Most peacekeeping, the foreign language skills of the personnel are still at a low level. A considerable number of military scientific and technical personnel with master's degree feel that their foreign language skills are incompetent. The author believes that improving the foreign language ability of the Chinese military should be placed on the important agenda, and the relevant administrative agencies should be established as soon as possible. Carefully analyzing the national and military conditions of China, we have to fully tape and use the military and civilian resources. China always talk about the military-civil integration, civil-military integration. So here also in language aspect, they are talking about use of military and civilian resources and formulate a long-term plan for the development of foreign language capabilities of Chinese military as soon as possible. This will enable Chinese military's foreign language capabilities to not only serve the country's security and peaceful rise, but also comprehensively improve the overall quality of Chinese military personnel. Now, military translation research in China. Translation and interpreters during the Opium War between Britain and China. Lawrence Wong writes that during Opium War, both China and British side were highly dependent on translators and interpreters. Chinese side took the services of Tongxir, who were not much competent in Chinese as well as in English. The first Chinese translator was Lin Zexu. He set up his team, but a very few Chinese nationals were willing to learn a foreign language at that time. In China, translators were regarded as traitors or evildoers and condemned as Han Chien. The outcome of the Afyon War would have been different had Chinese side employed trained translators and interpreters. Now let's talk about history of military translation in China. Wu Shufan opines that the military translation has a long history and the rich practice. However, lacks the research on its theories and techniques. China has been interested in the translation of the foreign materials into Chinese. Military translation started when wars between tribes and ethnic groups in different languages occurred. In late Ming Dynasty, some scholars started translating Western military books and compiled such book as San Chi Fu, Si Fa Shen Qi, Huo Gong Xiao, the Book of Artifacts, the Western French Magic Machine, and Huo Gong Xiao, and they have been used in the manufacture of sighting device of guns. So on the eve of the First Afyon War, the Lin Zexu paid attention to the collecting foreign language information and studying the enemy's situation. After the defeat of the Second Afyon War, the Qing dynasty paid the much attention to the introduction of Western military theory and technology and organized the translation and compilation of military works, such as tactics, new theory of coastal defense, the true art of firearms, and the new books on the military science. The earliest military translators in the Chinese militia were the oldest revolutionaries, Comrade Wu Xiuquan and Marshal Liu Po-chang. After the founding of People's Republic of China, Chinese army faced the imperialistic blockade and siege and soon joined the war to resist US aggression and at Korea. The Party Central Committee has paid the considerable attention to the military translation. On the eve of founding of the People's Republic of China in 1949, the Military Commission began preparations for the establishment of foreign language schools and successively recruited the young intellectuals to cultivate the foreign language talents. In the mid-1950s, under the care of the Marshal Liu Po-chang and Ye Qian-ying, the first translation conference of the whole army was held. Today, Chinese army has a strong multilingual translation team. In a series of patriotic wars and international struggles for resisting US aggression and adding Korea to self-defense and counterattack against Vietnam, from successful explosion of China's first atomic bomb in 1964 to the recent Long March 2, in the process of development of production of a series of advanced weapon and equipment, carrier rockets, in introducing foreign military theory documents and materials, promoting military science research, as well as in developing the international military exchanges and cooperation and enhancing mutual understanding between the militaries of various countries. They have worked hard and made dedication silently. This word silently is important, as translators have always been anonymous. However, their achievements are tangible and indelible. So now next, let's talk about the shortcomings in the existing research on the history of Chinese military translation. So Wang Xiangping believes that there are three reasons for these deficiencies. Means deficiency in the history of Chinese military translation, research on history of Chinese military translation. First is, military translation usually has a sacred nature and military translators emphasize the collective identity, which makes the military translation topics rarely enter in the academic circle for communication and military translation research. Although some academic seminars on the military translation studies have been held in the recent years, these conferences have relatively little influence in the academic circles. Second, there are very limited professionals in the military engaged in the translation research. And they have been not been able to fully exploit the military translation historical material to form our research situation. The third is not pay enough attention to the application of methodology. The author believes that under the current deepening of new military reforms, a systematic and in-depth study of the history of Chinese military translation is urgently needed. What it needs, studying the history of Chinese military translation, has great practical and theoretical significance. Chinese military activities in international peacekeeping, joint military exercises, military diplomacy, cutting-edge weapons, high sea escort, new international order, etc., become more frequent, and military translation plays a more important role. It is necessary to draw some experience and lessons from the history of military translation. Use history as mirror and increase the intensity and breadth of translation of military services. Now, Murray and Wang Xiangping, in their paper entitled The Status Quo and Prospects of Military Translation Studies, talking on the current status of military translation research at home and abroad, emphasize that modern warfare increasingly involves huge differences in language and cultures across national borders. Knowing how to use the multilingual notional systems to serve the war is essential to the war process. Translation services are one of the cores, from recruiting new recruits to discussing propaganda, from drafting reports to collecting intelligence, from improving weapons and equipment to optimizing the strategies and tactics, from openly declaring war to military negotiations and peace building. Translation plays an important role in these war activities, involving cross-cultural propaganda and communication. Translation has always been an inseparable war machine. In the current globalized context, the focus on language and cultural symbol systems has moved to the center position in many military operations. And finally, conclusion. From above deliberations, we see that domain of military translation is extremely important for effective functioning of the military's today's multilingual military in today's multilingual and multicultural context. It is a part of linguistic support to the armed forces. Foreign language capabilities are as important as critical weapon system and an integral part of core combat capabilities. China greatly benefited itself by the translation of Western military documents, translation of military theory, military technology, military intelligence, and military foreign activities has foreign relations has fulfilled China's broader strategy of strengthening its forces. Learning foreign technology and getting valuable intelligence input for its missions and also effectively manage its foreign related activities. We must take a lesson from Chinese status. As we have seen, China has taken lesson from USA. They have studied their roadmap, study and learned lesson. Similarly, on the same line, we have must take lesson from Chinese strategy, value and enrich our foreign language resources, especially Chinese language resources, and systematically train the resources for our future needs. Chinese being one of the toughest languages, translation of military documents for the above mentioned purposes and carrying out the research from Chinese sources need to be strengthened in our country as well, so that we can uphold our larger national interests in the time to come. Thank you. Thank you very much for patience here.
Well, that was a very wonderful presentation. Definitely excellent. The research that you have done is in depth, as we can see from your presentation. However, I would like to ask you certain questions, if that will, you know, give our viewers a much more, you know, idea, much more better idea about the use of certain Chinese ancient ideologies, whether they have had any influence on the current Chinese military translations. For example, you have talked about the Sun Tzu Binfa. So has this art of war have had any influence, the ancient ideology have had any influence on Chinese military translations of other nations, other nations' strategies, or maybe, you know, how other nations have translated Chinese military strategies?
Chinese, this Art of War is a very famous book, and it has not only got influence on Chinese strategy, but on overall in the entire world. This is a very renowned book. Even its principles are used not only in military field, but in business field also. So this, actually the main thing is before fighting, there are principles, certain very good principles are before fighting the enemy, just subjugate the enemy, means just paralyze them, right, by the psychological warfare. And yes, they are just using in today's context also, like during Doklam crisis or Galwan in prior time, you have seen a lot of articles in media. They are talking about their strength, their power. So these are all based on their strategy. Means before fighting, let's paralyze the army, enemy before fighting. So that is one of the thing. And as for the military translation is concerned, yes, China has taken it very seriously, because translation is a sharp weapon which China thinks for learning from the West. Because China, though they were just having certain advancement in science and technology and other aspects, but they have learned from West a lot, right? They learned their military strategy, they learned in science and technology. So a lot of translation work has been done in China. I think we are not having such type of project, because we are conversant in English, which is the international language, and all the literature is available. But when we talk about the Chinese knowledge, right? Whatever Chinese ideology, whatever Chinese literature is there, and it is not available to us, right? So that needs to be translated, whether it is in military field, whether it is in science and technology. So that is required. So, of course, the Art of War is a very important Chinese book, which has got influence in the past and today as well. Their basic ideology, their military thinking is based on that. Okay.
There is another question that I would like to ask you. You talked about this translations from, you know, foreign languages to Chinese, and Chinese translations to foreign languages. So my question is regarding the translations done in within China itself. For example, you know, from Chinese to Tibetan maybe, or maybe the language of Xinjiang or Mongolian. What do you have to say about that?
Actually, translation as a mode of intercultural communication. So in China itself, in domestic level itself, when China is taking that much importance as international level, translating English document, of course, China is paying attention to the translation of Chinese to Tibet and Tibetan to Chinese. So because this is of a strategic value, right? I've got not much research, much idea about it. But I think Chinese to Tibetan. Chinese officials, Chinese government officials have definitely learned the Tibetan as well, right? and they are just translating, because translation is for intelligence purpose, right? If you want to control any reason, definitely you need the intelligence, and for intelligence, language is first thing. And if there is a communication gap, there are different languages, so translation comes into play. So definitely China would have developed their other domestic translation field, because the number of translators in China is huge number. Means it is in, I'll just read somewhere, it is in lakhs, even you can say reach to the millions. All right. So that, not having any in-depth knowledge about the Chinese, Tibetan or any other language. Yes, as for a Chinese English translation is concerned, yes, China, you know, is giving full thrust on learning English, and translation also. So translation research is also at a very advanced level in China.
Well, now you are saying that there are many translators involved in military translation in China, and you know, it's going on at a very, it's being carried out at a very advanced level. So, one question that I would like to ask you is how exactly do the Chinese train these military translators? And do they have a separate unit or something for specially for this military translations, or you know, maybe they are the university students or some other, you know, department that is involved in these translations, and what kind of precise method has been used for this? Can you shed some light on that?
Okay. So as far as training of translator is concerned, first of all, let's understand the what are the competencies required for translation. Actually, for a translator, there are six type of competencies which are required to have. First is the bilingual knowledge, right? If you are working in Chinese and English, you must have thorough knowledge of Chinese as well as in English, right? You have to be one thing is there, you should be in the target language in which you are translating, you must be native. That is the first requirement at international level. So you must have a native or near native proficiency. So the language, bilingual knowledge, then comes the cultural knowledge. Cultural knowledge, that you must be aware about the culture of the two countries. When we are talking about the military translation, so the culture of militaries comes into this play, right? You must, you are translating the Western literature, you must have knowledge about the organization structure, like their strategies of the Western militaries. So that knowledge is required. So second is your thematic knowledge, which is called thematic knowledge. So the translators who have got in-depth knowledge of the military matters, means those who are from military itself, they are the best translators. We cannot ask anyone to translate military matters, it will not be successful. That's why China definitely would have been are training their military officers in English language, and those who are proficient, then they are converted into Chinese translators, English translator, because they are from military, they have got military background knowledge, they are Chinese, and they have got sound knowledge in English, right? Then there are other competencies like thematic knowledge, which we will talk, that is called encyclopedic knowledge. For a translator, you are required to know encyclopedic knowledge, means knowledge of everything. You are working in military, you should know about Army, Navy, Air Force, their weapon system, their strategy, their rank structure, means lot of things, even technology, right? So the requirement is very high. You should have general knowledge. Then one more thing is technical competence. Means you should be techno-savvy. You must know the modern technology, what is going on. Like today we have got machine translation, computer-aided translation, CAT in which we use the memory, all right? And this also requires some knowledge of documentation, how to get information from the various sources. So this is third aspect. And fourth is the knowledge of the translation theories. Means you can't be translator without knowing the translation principles and theories. So these are four things. Then one is the strategic knowledge. That is problem solving competence. Means you should be able to solve the problem then and there by any means. So these are the main five competencies which a translator need to have. So as far as training is concerned, so first is English knowledge, right? So they are trained in English and then they are given the translator training, because translation, any bilingual cannot be a translator, it is very sure. So for translation, there is a specific training that is training of these aspects, like training of technology, training of thematic knowledge is also developed, and language is also brushed, and your that is called your translation principles. So in this way, this is the comprehensive method which China might be using, because I want learn, yes, but I know how the translators can be trained in the best way. So first of all, enrich their language, because sometimes what happens in Chinese military officer or even China, English have got some problem. They have got some problem. That's why Chinglish word that emerges, Chinese way of English, writing English. So there are certain limitations, some problem, because we have talked in the lecture also, because their foreign language capability, especially in English, is not that good, right? Though they have got good translators, I have met them during border personnel meeting along China-India border, and they are proficient enough. So China is making very means good efforts in this area.
Well, talking about this border personnel negotiations that you have been to actually. Can you give us one example of, you know, the differences between interpretation between the foreign and the Chinese negotiators during these kind of military negotiations, if that exists any, if there exists any, please.
Actually, border personnel meetings are actually meant for resolving the local military disputes, right? And these are conducted on a set time along the 2-3 places along the border. And these are set twice in a year. So these will be held, and whatever the pending issues are there, they are established. And one important thing is that is establishing confidence building measures. Strengthening the friendship, we can say, strengthening the Bohomi, the peace. So that is the main target. So they meet together in a very friendly environment, in very, you can say, formal atmosphere. They discuss their issues, try to resolve then and there, and these are not resolved. They are just give assurance to, okay, these issues will be discussed at the higher level. And then there are one more thing is the informal discussion is also important part of border personnel meeting. So after formal meeting, officers meet each other. They just know each other, know about the culture of each other, and be friendly somewhere. So these meetings solve a purpose of making very good friendly relations between the two great armies. So that is, and these border personnel meetings solve purpose, like in Galwan, we have seen these are the very higher level, core commander level meetings, in which senior officers, even the representatives from the foreign ministry, they also participate and be the part of delegation. So these are very important tool for resolving the problems, border problems, through negotiation.
Can you give us one example of if there are any differences in the way Chinese translate things, and maybe if Indian counterparts translate the Chinese materials. Can you give us an example of that?
Chinese, their original Chinese, and what we translate. Difference between that.
What are the differences in the Chinese translations and the Indian translations?
Difference, there is no such difference, because whatever we translate, we translate based on the convention, based on the language traditions, or language means called rules. We translate according to that. And there is hardly any communication gap, right? And as far as Chinese side translation is concerned, that is also of same level. There's no much difference. Because English, we see this concept as the standard, right? And same in our case. Our translation also, we can't say it is perfect one. Yeah, there may be some scope of improvement. But as far as communication is concerned, we are able to successfully communicate, and that is.
Well, that was a very interesting dialogue with you there. And thank you very much for having this dialogue with us. I believe that we have learned a lot from this dialogue, not just us, but also our viewers. So thank you very much for participating in this dialogue. Thank you all the viewers for watching our episode. We will meet in our next episode. So keep watching and keep learning, and do subscribe to our channel.
Okay, thank you very much.